crashes over me, crashes over me. For you are for us, you are not against us. Champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter in.
All right, so how many of you remember the stuff that kept you up at night as a kid? Like when you were little, maybe things that kind of kept you up at night. Remember anything, maybe there's something in your closet or something like that. Anybody remember that kind of stuff? Anybody remember that? Just a few of you. The rest of you are probably still kind of scared of that kind of stuff happening. Right? I mean, you're not alone. You're not alone if you remember that, because they made a whole movie about it. Remember the movie Monsters, Inc.? Right? That was the whole point of the movie, was there's something in your closet. It's going to come out at night. And it's going to scare you and then save your screams to power their cities. Now, maybe you thought of something was in your closet at night, but it wasn't probably Mike Wachowski or Sully. What was it? Well, probably like a sweater hanging there, kind of looked kind of funny. Or maybe it was the neighbor had a big tree in their yard, and the moonlight would shine through it on your wall, makes it kind of scary looking thing on your wall, and move back and forth. What did you do whenever that happened? Probably called your parents, right? And what did they do? Well, they came in and flipped on a light and said, "See, nothing to be afraid of. Everything's fine." Well, when you get to be an adult and you get a little older, you kind of think, man, it would be great if our fears were like that as an adult, that you could just like flip a switch and phew, it all go away. Everything's great. But as you get older, you find that these fears don't go away so easily. And they begin to invade our lives and our thoughts and our consciousness. Several years ago, almost 30 years ago, there was a song done by William Jones, Billy Joel, just being a joke. All right, Billy Joel. All right, and maybe you might know this song. All right, so listen to this little part. Listen to the words, though, to this part of the song. That song. Yeah, right? You probably can sing the words to it. Here's the thing. That song was written in 1989, the year that Billy Joel turned 40. And it was written about events, 100 headlines, from 1949, the year he was born, to 1989, the year he turned 40. 100 headlines. And here's the cool thing about it, or maybe the sad thing about it, is the things he lists, some pretty scary stuff, haven't changed in almost 30 years. So the same things he mentions, you just heard, could be sung today. So here's the thing. He's right. We didn't start the fire. It's always been burning as long as the world's been turning. And it's not going to change. We are going to have to face fear in our lives. Our kids, our grandkids will have to face fear. It's going to happen. As long as the world's been turning, it's going to go on and go on and go on. So the thing is, we need to figure out how to deal with it. We can't just put the light switch. We can't put it under the covers and make it go away. We've got to find positive ways to deal with our fear. So let me ask you, what keeps you up at night? I'm not talking the little stuff, like, will the Cubs choke in the playoffs again this year? Probably. But the big stuff, right? The big fears that we have. Like, what happens to my kids? Or that conflict I'm having at work with that coworker that keeps me up at night. Losing businesses. Fears of finishing last. Fears of having bad grades. Fear of the future or things we can't control. Maybe the fear of going broke, being sued, aging parents, kids going to college. Do people care about me? What do they think about me? Does that mole on my back, does it mean anything? Is God disappointed in me? What happens when I die? So the question is, can you name your fear? The cause. What is it that keeps you up at night? Because the things that keep us up at night, those fears are like wolves. Right? The sun goes down, you feel a chill in the air, it's getting dark, and you hear that wolf howling in the distance. You can't see it, but you know it's there. And it causes you to be afraid, to keep you up at night. And fear just doesn't keep us awake. It just doesn't steal our peace. What fear does is it distracts us in powerful ways. It can impair our normally good judgment. Fear can impair that. Fear can lead us to make very unwise decisions we wouldn't normally make. Fear can tie us up in knots, keep us from going forward, hold back our future. Edmund Burke said this, "No power so effectually robs the mind of all its power of acting and reasoning as fear." It has an incredibly powerful effect on us, and we have to learn how to deal with it so we're not tied up, so we're not paralyzed. Because God did not design us and does not have in plan for us a life of fear. In 2 Timothy, Paul writes, "God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline." So he gave us the tools to fight fear. You already have these tools. The tools are a spirit of power, self-discipline, making good choices, and love. In 1 John 4, it's written, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear." And God has given you that love. So he's given you these tools to combat fear. The question is, do we trust God enough to actually use them? So what if faith instead of fear was your dominant reaction to life's challenges? When tough things come along, when storms arise in our life and we're afraid, we hear that wolf crying out, we can't sleep. What if our default reaction was faith instead of fear? As you came in today, hopefully you got one of these blue pieces of paracord. If you didn't, they're on the way out. You can get them there. If you have one, what I want you to do is I want you to just tie a knot. Nothing fancy. It's not to be kind of some, you know, Eagle Scout, Stephen Bremer kind of knot. Just a knot. A normal knot is fine. All right? And I want you to name that knot when you do. Because fear is like that knot. It ties you up. Like you ever hear a knot in your stomach, right, from fear? Well, that's what this knot is. And throughout this week, maybe throughout this day, take this cord and I want you to start naming those fears. And I bet you're going to have more than just one knot in that piece of paracord. You may have a whole string of knots. But I want you to bring this with you to work at night. Just have it nearby and begin putting a name to those fears. And as we go through the next few weeks of this series called Fear Not, we want to try to find ways that the scriptures and the life of God and prayer can help us untie those knots. Find ways of positively, faithfully dealing with our fears. Now the truth is, sometimes what will happen is, you'll untie a knot and be like, oh man, okay, I've dealt with that fear. And then a few hours later, or a day later, a week later, you find yourself tying the same knot again. And that's okay. It's a process. But it's a choice to work through, because faith and fear cannot exist in the human heart at the same time. They can't. Of those two, faith and fear, only one of those comes from God. And it's not fear. So we have to learn to deal with our fear, because God says over and over again, fear not. In the New Testament, there are 125 commands, imperatives that Jesus gives us, things he tells us to do or to be, 125 of them. Of those 125, about 20%, about 21 of them have the same theme. Fear not. Don't be afraid. Be of good courage. Take heart. A sixth of all the things he tells us to do or to be is simply don't be afraid. The next closest one to those 21 is only 8. So the thing we can learn from this is that God does care about your fears. All those knots you put in your rope, all of them, Jesus cares about them, every single one. And he's given you the power to untie them. And then he goes a step further. He gives us examples from his own life. Look, Jesus didn't live a life that was sunny and 75 the whole time. He dealt with some pretty powerful storms. I mean, I'm talking about real storms in the Gospels. There are 6 times we are told of storms, real life storms, that Jesus has to deal with and his disciples have to deal with. And they have lessons for us about how we deal with the storms in our lives, with our fear. We're going to look at 2 today from the Gospel of Matthew. It happens twice. The first one is in Matthew chapter 8. And you can follow along here on the screens or on the app, on the Chaparral app. Matthew 8, 23. When he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. A windstorm arose on the sea, so great that the boat was being swamped by the waves. But Jesus was asleep. So on this lake, Sea of Galilee, going across, no big deal, and boom, storm pops up. Now Matthew, who wrote this, was one of the disciples. So he was there. He can remember the rain stinging his face. He can remember the wind blowing around him, the slap of the sail against the mast, and the stuff sliding all over the deck. And so when he describes this storm, it's not just a squall or something like that, a little downpour. The Greek word he uses here is pretty powerful. It's one I bet you can figure out. He calls this storm a seismos. In fact, he calls it a seismos megas. Now, megas means what? Mega, which means like big, huge, great, like a mega candy bar, a mega donut, right? That kind of stuff. Well, it's seismos. Anybody want to guess what that means? Seismograph? Seismology? Earthquake. What he's saying is, on this lake, there's a huge earthquake of a storm. He only uses this exact phrase, Matthew does, 4 times. Once to describe the end of the world. In Matthew 24, he's describing the end of the world, and he says it's like a seismos megas, this huge earthquake. When Jesus dies, it says there's an earthquake, and uses this phrase, seismos megas. And then when Jesus rises from the dead, it says an angel comes down, rolls a stone away, and there is a seismos megas. So this isn't just a storm. This is like an earth-shattering event. And the disciples are caught in the middle of it. And there's something else about this seismos megas I want you to pick up on. The disciples who are caught in this are the good guys. Right? They're just following Jesus. He gets in the boat, it says, and they follow him. And they go across the sea, and then this happens. They're the good guys. And you think, well, shouldn't Jesus have known about this? Like, couldn't he have said, hey guys, it's going to storm tonight, let's just go tomorrow? Or, hey guys, it's going to get rough out there, bring life vests and some Dramamine, you're going to get sick, or whatever. He doesn't say any of that. And I think we can learn a very simple lesson from this. If we follow Jesus into the boat, if we get on board with Jesus, it's not going to be sunny and 75 all the time. Sometimes we're going to get caught in a seismos megas. Sometimes we're going to get wet. It's going to be a mess. It's going to be a storm. Jesus said in John 16, in this world, guess what? You're going to have trouble. It's going to happen. And so we have to learn is how to deal with the storms and the fears that we have in the midst of those storms. Those things are going to keep us up late at night. Now Jesus, by the way, while this is all going on, what is he doing? Sleeping, right? This seismos megas doesn't keep him up at night. And it says in Matthew 8:25, the disciples went and woke him and said, Lord, save us. We're perishing. They go to him because they believe he can do something about it. He can still the storm or save the boat or do something. So they go wake him up. In Mark's gospel, the same story has a little twist to it. In Mark's gospel, it says that he was asleep and they go wake him up and they say this, "Teacher, don't you care that we are perishing?" I like that better, because that kind of connects with me. Ever been there in the middle of the night, can't sleep, you're worried, something's bugging you, and you say, "God, don't you care? I mean, I know you can do something about it, so why don't you? Why don't you turn a light on, or fix it, or just calm the storm, but do something. Don't you care that I'm afraid? Don't you care that there's a storm going on in my life?" Because it's one thing, by the way, to have strength and have faith when things are good. When it's sunny and nice, we're going to be all faithful. When the storm comes, our fear begins to rise and our faith begins to sink. Because fear and faith can't exist in the same heart at the same time. So when fear rises, our faith begins to sink. If you're a math whiz, like Bly Hostetler back there, it's inversely proportional, right? As faith goes up, fear has to go down. As fear goes up, faith goes down too. And so these disciples, when they say, "God, don't you care?" they're kind of questioning the character of God, because God has said again and again and again, "Don't be afraid. Take courage." So the question is, do we believe him? Do we believe that we don't have to be afraid in the storms, that God is aware of them, that he's there in the boat with us? Look, you may be tying a bunch of knots in this rope this week. Maybe a whole bunch of knots. We believe that God cares about them, but do we trust God enough to help us untie them? Do we trust? Do we have the faith that God is bigger than the storms? That he's in control? And that he's with us, even in the midst of them? Well, Jesus wakes up, and it says that he calms the storm. But first, look what he says here. He says, "Why are you afraid, you of little faith?" Then he got up, rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a dead calm. What's the first thing he does when he wakes up? He doesn't stop the storm. The first thing he does when he wakes up is talk to the disciples. I think that's super important. Because where's the real storm? Not outside the boat, but the real storm's inside their hearts. It's their perception. Because here's the reality. He talks to them first because he knows there are going to be other storms, not just this one they're going to deal with. He's talking to them about their perception of the storm and their fear. And he says, "Why are you afraid, you of little faith?" Right? When fear rises, faith sinks. You can see right here in Jesus' word. There is no earthly situation that is outside of God's power. I don't care if it's your finances or flunking a class, if it's that pathology report or that pesky neighbor, there is nothing that can take us out of God's hand. And so Jesus comes to us first and deals with the storm inside of us. Look, he may not be able to, or may not want to calm the storm around us, or maybe not the way we want to be calm. What he cares about is calming the storm inside of us, saying, "Don't be afraid." Now, we said earlier that there was a second storm in the Gospel of Matthew, and it kind of goes along with this one. It's in Matthew 14. In this story, Jesus has had his own storm in his own life. He's been healing people, feeding people. He's tired. He finds out that his cousin, his friend, the guy who baptized him, named John, was killed, beheaded by Herod Antipas. And so he wants to be alone. Just wants to pray, get away, just take some time, because there's a storm in his life. So he sends the disciples ahead in a boat across the sea. I mean, look, they're fishermen. They can handle it. They've seen what he can do in a storm, right? So they're fine. Well, they go across the lake about 3 in the morning, or 4 in the morning, somewhere in there, a storm raises up. And the disciples become afraid. And here we find in this story, something happens in Matthew 14, 25. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." So did the disciples learn from the first storm not to be afraid? I don't know, maybe not. So it causes us to ask a question. How close does Jesus need to be? Does he need to be in the boat? Near the boat? Walking toward the boat? How close does he have to be for us to not fear? Because here's the thing, he knew about the storm. He's on the shore, he can see it. But yet the disciples were still afraid because he wasn't maybe there in the boat this time. But he was nearby. Then something happens we can all identify with when it comes to dealing with fear. Peter ignores the storm for a little bit and he sees Jesus coming and he says, "Jesus, you know, if you command me to come out to you, I can walk on the water too. So do that. Command me to come out to you." Jesus says, "All right, come here. Water's fine." Peter gets out of the boat, fixes his eyes on Jesus, and begins walking toward Jesus. But then it says in Matthew, he noticed the strong wind and became frightened. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Why does he sink? Because as fear goes up, your faith begins to sink. And so does Peter. He sees the wind and the waves. He's like, uh-oh. And he focuses on the fear. And then he himself begins to sink right into the waves. And Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When he got into the boat, the wind ceased. You may have already caught it, but do you see the parallel between these two stories? If you look at them side by side, there's a really cool parallel here. Back in Matthew 8, he says to the disciples, "Why are you afraid, you of little faith?" And here, in this story, he says to Peter, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" So, again, if fear goes up, faith begins to sink. We see that in both these two little phrases here. But notice that fear and doubt are parallel. Fear and doubt are parallel in this story, or these two stories, rather. And when it says that Peter doubted, it wasn't that he didn't believe in Jesus, or didn't believe he was powerful enough to make him walk on the water. The word in Greek means he was divided. His mind was divided, and fear does that to us. It divides our allegiances. It divides our mind. Peter's walking along, and all of a sudden he sees wave, Jesus. Big wave, Jesus. Huge storm, Jesus. As he focuses on the fear, and it goes up, his faith begins to sink, and so does he. And it happens with us too. This week, you're going to tie some knots. I guarantee it. You're going to see stuff in the news, in your life, at work, at school, that are going to cause you to start tying knots. When you do, I want you to remember two things. The first is that God is near. We need to trust that Jesus is with us. Maybe not in the boat with us, but he says he's near. He is with us. He knows about the storms. He knows about your fear. And the second thing is this. We have to remember that Jesus cares about our fears in such a way that he's going to calm the storm in us. But we have to trust him to do that. It's a decision. You have to choose. You have to decide. I'm going to focus on my faith. I'm going to focus on what Jesus has called me to do, who he's called me to be, what he's done for me, the power he has. I'm going to focus on that and not on my fear. And then untie that knot. Yeah, you might tie it again. But when you do, go back to these two things. Trust that Jesus is with you and trust that he cares about your fears. And try to untie those knots this week. And try to leave them that way. Let's pray together.